So my today's topic is anticholinergic drugs. Anticholinergic drugs. That means these are the agents that is acting against the activity of cholinergic drugs. These agents are also known as cholinergic blockers. Cholinergic blockers. That means these agents will block the activity of the cholinergic drugs, or these agents can also be known as cholinergic antagonist. Cholinergic antagonists all means one and the same. Now when I am saying it as cholinergic blockers or cholinergic antagonist means something is related to receptors. So basically these anticholinergic drugs mainly act by blocking the receptor. They are basically cholinergic receptor antagonist. If you remember, antagonist means these are the agents that will have affinity but no intrinsic activity. Okay, now suppose this is any of your peripheral organ, suppose your heart, and suppose this is your cholinergic neuron which is releasing acetylcholine. So acetylcholine has got the ability to bind with the receptor present on the heart. So ability of any ligand molecule to bind with a receptor is known as affinity. And after binding with the receptor, it will start producing some conformational changes in this receptor. Like suppose if it is a kind of muscarinic receptor, means here guanosyl diphosphate will be converted into guanosyl triphosphate. Then the alpha subunit will move to an enzyme that is adenylyl cyclase, and that enzyme will be inhibited. And the beta gamma subunit will approach to the potassium channel and will cause opening of the potassium channel. So all such activities is something happening in the receptor. So that activity that occurs in the receptor is known as intrinsic activity. So acetylcholine or any of your cholinergic agonistic molecule have got both affinity as well as your intrinsic activity. But here what happens in cholinergic antagonist means here even this antagonistic molecule will have affinity. Affinity means these agents will also come and they will bind with the receptor. But there will not be any kind of intrinsic activity. Means the receptor won't be getting activated. There is no conformational changes occurring in the receptor molecule. So this is how these cholinergic antagonistic molecule or your cholinergic blockers will produce the action. Even they have got the affinity. Means these agent will also approach to the receptor and they will bind with the receptor. And after binding with the receptor, they will not produce any kind of conformational changes in the receptor molecule. So this is what exactly happens in here in this case. This is what the mechanism of action is. So these cholinergic antagonist molecule, these are kind of competitive inhibitors. Means if the concentration of the cholinergic antagonist is more, they will inhibit the action of the cholinergic agonist. Okay, so basically what this agent will do means they will just block the receptor, so that whatever acetylcholine or any cholinergic agonistic molecule will come here, they will fail to bind with the receptor. So this is the main mechanism of action of this cholinergic antagonist. They have got affinity, means they will bind with the receptor, but they will not produce any action. They will just sit silently. So this is what happens in the cholinergic blockers. So cholinergic blockers, basically they target in the receptor, and after binding with the receptor, they will inhibit the action of the cholinergic mechanisms. Okay, now this is what happens in your cholinergic antagonist or anticholinergic drugs. Now coming to the classification. So basically this anticholinergic drugs since they block the receptor, so depending upon the receptor we can classify anticholinergic drugs into the drugs that will block muscarinic receptor and the drugs that blocks the nicotinic receptor. So we have got muscarinic blockers and we have got nicotinic blockers. Now, under muscarinic blockers, we have got a drug that is known as your atropine that can block all the five types of receptors of your muscarin. So we call them as non-selective blockers. Non-selective blockers. Okay. So non-selective blockers means these agents will block the all the five subtypes of your muscarinic receptors. And there are few drugs that will block only selectively, only just M1 receptor, or there are some blockers that will only block M2 receptor. There are few blockers that will block only M3 receptor. So on that basis we have got selective blockers. Selective blockers means these agents will selectively block the muscarinic receptor. Like we have got few drug that will block only and only M1 receptor. Like M1 receptor is mainly present in the gastric gland and it is mainly involved in the gastric acid secretion. So by giving M1 blocker we can inhibit the gastric acid secretion. There are few drugs that will block only M2 receptor. M2 receptors are basically present in your heart. Okay, and after blocking the M2 receptor, what will happen? The normal action of activation of M2 receptor was to produce tachycardia. And when we block the M2 receptor, the normal action of the M2 receptor, which is mediated by acetylcholine, is bradycardia. Okay, decrease in the heart rate. And if we are giving any M2 receptor blocker, means it will produce tachycardia. See, we have got M3 receptor in so many areas. We have got M3 receptor present in your eyes. It is present in various glands. It is present in your various smooth muscle like your GI tract, in your respiratory tract, in your urinary tract. And we have got drugs that will specifically bind with the M3 receptor that to specific location. Like we have got drugs that will block the M3 receptor in our eyes. We have got anticholinergic drugs that will block the M3 receptor in your smooth muscle. We have got certain anticholinergic drug that will block M3 receptor in our glands. Okay, so much selectivity we have. So on that basis, the muscarinic blockers can be divided into non-selective blockers and selective blockers. Non-selective blockers will block all the five types of muscarinic receptor, whereas selectively blockers will selectively block any one or two types of the muscarinic receptors. Next, coming to the nicotinic blockers. As we know, we have got two types of nicotinic receptor. First one is NN receptor present in the autonomic ganglion, and second one is your NM receptor, which is present in the neuromuscular junction. Okay. So we have got drugs that will block the NN receptor, which is present in the autonomic ganglion, and we have got certain anticholinergic drugs that will block the receptor, that is NM receptor, which is basically present in the skeletal muscle. So in that cases we call NN blockers as ganglionic blockers and NM blockers like neuromuscular blockers. Okay, so this classification you can also remember in this manner. Suppose this is your brain. So in your brain also you have got so many cholinergic neurons, and wherever are the cholinergic neurons will be there cholinergic receptors. So we have got nicotinic receptor as well as muscarinic receptors. Okay. Now suppose if we consider first of all the case of parasympathetic nervous system, we have got a long preganglionic neuron and a short postganglionic neuron, and next we have got some effector organ. Okay. Similarly, we have got sympathetic nervous system with a small preganglionic neuron and a long postganglionic neuron, and next we have got a neuroeffector organ. In case of parasympathetic nervous system, in both pre as well as post ganglionic neuron, acetylcholine is your neurotransmitter. Now if acetylcholine is the neurotransmitter over here, then here should reside the cholinergic receptor. Similarly, if acetylcholine is the neurotransmitter in the post ganglionic neuron, means its receptor should reside over here in the neuroeffector organ. Okay. Similarly, in case of sympathetic nervous system, when this is the neuron that contains acetylcholine as a न्यूरोट्रांसमीटर मीन्स इट्स रिसेप्टर शुड रिसाइड ओवर हियर. ओके दिस बोथ आर दी गैंग्लियंस वेर यू कैन फाइंड दी एन एन रिसेप्टर. ओके ऑटोनॉमिक गैंग्लियन. नेक्स्ट इन द सिंपथैटिक पोस्ट गैंग्लियोनिक न्यूरोन इन मोस्ट ऑफ द केसेस नॉर एपिनेफ्रिन विल बी द न्यूरो ट्रांसमीटर. सो ओवर हियर ओवर दिस एरिया यू विल नॉट फाइंड द कोलिनर्जिक रिसेप्टर. ओके सो इन द सिंपथैटिक पोस्ट गैंग्लियोनिक न्यूरोन मोस्टली नॉर एपिनेफ्रिन विल बी द न्यूरो ट्रांसमीटर एक्सेप्ट द पोस्ट गैंग्लियोनिक न्यूरोन विच इज यू नो अप्रोचिंग टू योर स्वेट ग्लैंड्स एंड फ्यू blood vessels. Because in sweat glands and in blood vessels the sympathetic post ganglionic neuron contains acetylcholine as a neurotransmitter. Since acetylcholine will be the neurotransmitter, the cholinergic receptor will be present in the appropriate effector organ. Now when we talk about this autonomic ganglion, here the receptor present will be the NN receptor. And over here in the post ganglionic neuro effector junction the receptor present will be your muscarinic receptor. And of course the last but not the least we have got a long cholinergic neuron which will be approaching to your skeletal muscle and here you will find basically an M kind of receptor. Okay so basically anticholinergic drugs are the drugs which will block NN receptor and M receptors as well as the muscarinic receptors. Okay so and obviously there are few anticholinergic drugs that can cross the blood brain barrier and move inside the brain and inside the brain they will start producing the anticholinergic activity. Okay now the drugs that are basically blocking the NN receptor which is present in the autonomic ganglion, such agents are known as ganglionic blockers. Ganglionic blockers. Ganglionic blockers are the blockers which will block the receptor present in the autonomic ganglion. And what is a receptor present in the autonomic ganglion? Yes, it is NN receptor. Okay. Next, we have got certain anticholinergic drugs that will block the NM receptor. And where is this NM receptor present? Yes, it is present in the neuromuscular junction. So we have got neuromuscular blockers. Neuromuscular blockers means these are the anticholinergic drugs that will basically block the receptor present in the neuromuscular junction, and the receptor which will find in the neuromuscular junction is a kind of NM receptor. Okay so NN receptor blocker are known as ganglionic blockers and NM receptor blockers are known as neuromuscular blockers. Lastly, the receptor which is present in the neuroeffector junction, which is present in the neuroeffector organ, is basically the muscarinic receptor. So the anticholinergic drugs that will block the muscarinic receptor are known as muscarinic blockers or anti-muscarinic drugs. We can say anything. Muscarinic blockers or anti-muscarinic drugs. So basically anti-muscarinic drugs blocks the muscarinic receptor. It means anti-muscarinic drugs are primarily blocking the neuroeffector transmitter at the parasympathetic system. That means the anti-muscarinic drugs can also be known as parasympatholytics. Lytics. Okay so parasympatholytics means the agent that lyses the action at the activity of parasympathetic nervous system at the neuroeffector organ. Okay and as such conventionally the anticholinergic drugs are which blocks the action of acetylcholine on the autonomic effectors and in the CNS which is basically exerted by your muscarinic receptor. Undoubtedly, this NNNNM receptor, their activity is also mediated by acetylcholine. But the agents that will block NN receptor, we call them as ganglionic blockers, and the agents that block NM receptor, we call them neuromuscular blockers. And basically, mainly we'll study about the muscarinic blockers. Okay, because whatever neuroeffector organ over here are, it might be your heart, your lungs, your respiratory tract, your smooth muscle, your glands, and these agents. All agents, suppose if we take an example of heart has been innervated by both parasympathetic as well as sympathetic supply. Okay, heart is being innervated by the supply of both the autonomic nervous system, that is both parasympathetic nervous system will supply to the heart as well as sympathetic nervous system will supply to the heart. Okay, so what basically happens over here is the muscarinic receptor is basically the receptor of the parasympathetic nervous system. And if we are blocking this muscarinic receptor, so what will happen? The sympathetic nervous system will get activated. See, basically what happens is most of the organs like your heart or your respiratory tract, your glands, your urinary tract, your eyes, these organs are getting supply by both parasympathetic as well as sympathetic nervous system. Okay, but among this parasympathetic and sympathetic supply, the parasympathetic supply have got more dominant. Okay, the parasympathetic supply is more dominant as compared to sympathetic supply. But for producing action of this parasympathetic nervous system, it is produced via the receptor. And if what happens if you block these receptor? If you block these receptor, the parasympathetic nervous system is unable to produce the action. And if parasympathetic nervous system is unable to produce the action, then this organ will be left under the mercy of the sympathetic supply. Okay, like in your heart, the action of the parasympathetic nervous system is to produce bradycardia, and that bradycardia is mediated via the M2 receptor. What happens if you block the M2 receptor? There won't be bradycardia, but there will be supply of your sympathetic nervous system, and the action of the sympathetic supply on the heart is to produce tachycardia. Okay, so as such, anticholinergic drugs will not produce any action. They will just block the cholinergic or parasympathetic receptor. Rest, whatever activity occurs is because of an sympathetic supply. Okay, because of the sympathetic supply, because this organ is supplied by both parasympathetic and sympathetic neurons. If one is getting failing, then other is getting stronger and it is able to produce the action. Okay, so this is what exactly happens over here. Whenever we are blocking any muscarinic receptor, the activity of the parasympathetic nervous system will be stopped. And because of which, because of this inhibition of the parasympathetic activity, the sympathetic nervous system, which was previously inhibited, will now become activated, or you can say not activated, but it will become dominated over the parasympathetic nervous system. So this is basically what happens over here. Next, so here in anticholinergic drugs, basically we'll study about the muscarinic blockers. And next, regarding the nicotinic blockers, we'll study them in a separate topic as an drugs acting on autonomic ganglion and the neuromuscular blocker drugs. So basically now our main focus of the study will be muscarinic blockers. If in exam it is asked to write about parasympatholytic drugs or anticholinergic drugs, means you should mainly write about the muscarinic blockers. It does not include the nicotinic blockers. No doubt anticholinergic drugs means these are the drugs which also block the NN and NM receptor, but we have got a separate topic to study it. So parasympatholytics means the agents that will block the muscarinic receptors. Now, depending upon this, we have got classification of the muscarinic blockers. Okay, we have got classification. So basically, anticholinergic drugs are mainly classified into three types. Depending upon the origin, we have got natural alkaloids, we have got semi-synthetic derivatives, and lastly we have got synthetic compounds. In natural alkaloids, we have got two examples, atropine and hyoscine, also known as scopolamine. Since this atropine is a prototype drug means it is able to block all the five types of the muscarinic receptor. So natural alkaloids basically are of two types, atropine and hyoscine, also known as scopolamine. Next, coming to the semi-synthetic derivatives, we have got home atropine, atropine methonitrate, hyoscine butyl bromide, iprotropium bromide and tiotropium bromide. So these are the semi-synthetic derivatives. Next, we have got synthetic derivatives, and we have got four classes of it. First one is midriatics. Midriatics means these are the drugs which will produce midriasis, that is increase the size of the pupil. We have got two examples over here, cyclopentolate and tropicamide. Next class is anti-secretory and anti-spasmodics. So these agents have got mainly action in your GI tract. Again, we have got quaternary compound and tertiary amines. Quaternary compounds means these are the compounds somewhat like this. There will be charges on the nitrogen atom. That means these are having very low lipophilicity. Means they are not able to cross the biological membrane more efficiently. As compared to tertiary amines, the tertiary amines will be somewhat like this. There is no charges on the nitrogen atom. That means these tertiary amines are able to cross the biological membrane more efficiently as compared to the quaternary compounds. Okay. Now the examples of quaternary compounds are propanthiolene, oxyphenonium, isopropamide, clidinium, piperazoid methyl nitrate and glycopyrrolate. Okay, so these are the example of quaternary compounds. Tertiary amines are of three types, or three examples are there: dicyclomine, valathamate and pyrazepine. Next, we have got vesicoselective drugs. Vesicoselective drugs are basically have got action in your urinary system. They are reducing the contraction of the bladder. Examples are oxybutynane, flavoxate and tolterodine. And lastly, we have got anti-Parkinsonian drugs. We have got three example of the drugs. Those are trihexyphenidine, procyclidine and biberidine. Okay, so basically these are the classification of your anticholinergic drugs. We'll start our discussion with atropine, since atropine is a kind of prototype drug and it is able to block all the muscarinic receptor. And meanwhile, we'll also come across with these all drugs also. So we'll start our discussion with atropine. So atropine is a kind of prototype drug. It is an anticholinergic drug, and basically it is a natural alkaloid which is obtained from a plant known as Atropa belladonna. Okay, Atropa belladonna. See, basically Atropa means, previously means it was like at the age of stone age, those people used to use atropine for killing. Okay, because it produces all the actions which is opposite to that of the cholinergic agents. Like, what was the actions of the cholinergic drugs? If we recall, there will be large amount of sweating, lacrimation, salivation, heart rate will be reduced, and there will be increased abdominal peristalsis, increased urination, defecation. Okay, and quite opposite to that will happen in atropine. Like, in the glandular secretion, the cholinergic drugs used to increase the glandular secretion, but here all the glandular secretion will be reduced. Means there won't be any sweating, there won't be wetness of the eye and mouth, and nothing will be wet. Everything will go dry because it will mainly inhibit the all the kinds of glandular secretion. On the heart, it will produce a tachycardia. On the all the muscles or your smooth muscle, there will be reduced motility. So under increased dose of atropine, it may kill the person. So basically in the stone age or in the old age people, they used to use atropine as for killing anyone. So Atropa means these are the agents that will cut the thread of life. And belladonna. So belladonna means belladonna means beautiful lady. Now why we give belladonna as a name means, even nowadays, recently, models, what they will do, they will add some midriatic agents. Midriatic agents means these are the pupil dilators that will dilate the pupil. And when you dilate the pupil, it seems like girls look more attractive that time. So basically this atropine, when you add atropine in the eye, it will produce dilation of the pupil and the woman will feel like they look more attractive over there. So belladonna basically means beautiful lady, and pupil dilated is a mark of beautiful lady. So atropa belladonna, atropa means they can kill, belladonna means the woman may look beautiful. So that's why the name is given atropa belladonna. So quickly we'll go to the actions of this atropine. So first action we'll see on your central nervous system. Central nervous system. Okay. Now any drug, if it needs to produce some action on the central nervous system, is the very first requirement is it should cross the blood-brain barrier. Only after that it is able to produce some kind of central action, or you can say action on your central nervous system. Now the problem with atropine is when you consume atropine in a normal amount, 50%, just 50, or you can say 40 to 50%, is able to cross the blood-brain barrier. Okay, and it will not produce its normal action or the required action. So in order to produce any action on the central nervous system, we require higher doses of atropine to be consumed. Okay, so whenever atropine is consumed at higher doses, only in that condition it can cross the blood-brain barrier and sufficient amount of the drug will be made available in the central nervous system. Okay, at lower doses atropine will produce peripheral action, and if we want to see any action in the central nervous system, we need to give a higher doses of atropine. Okay, so atropine will produce action on the central nervous system at high dose. Now once inside the central nervous system, what kind of action you expect from atropine is it will basically produce stimulation of the medullary centers. Medullary center stimulation. Medullary centers such as your vagal, respiratory and vasomotor. Okay, so basically when given at higher doses, it will produce stimulation of medullary centers such as vagal, respiratory and vasomotor centers. And when it is available at a very higher dose, at very higher dose of this atropine, it causes cortical excitation. Okay, at higher doses, at very high dose, it can make the person a kind of mad, because there will be cortical excitation. Cortical means cerebral cortex. There will be cortical excitation. There will be restlessness, disorientation, even hallucination and delirium can occur. And delirium. Okay, so all these are the symptoms of your psychosis. Okay, so it may induce psychosis at higher doses. Okay, so this is about the action of atropine on your central nervous system. Now atropine, to produce any action in the central nervous system, we require a higher dose. Why we require higher dose means because only 40 to 50% of the drug can cross the blood-brain barrier, and rest will remain in your periphery. They will produce action and they will get metabolized in the liver. Okay, so when given at higher dose, it will produce medullary center stimulation, and if it is present at very higher dose, or in case of toxic dose, it will produce certain psychotic symptoms such as cortical excitation, restlessness, disorientation, hallucination and delirium. Okay, now along with atropine, we have got one more natural alkaloid, a friend of atropine, that is hyoscine, also known as scopolamine. So this hyoscine is also able to cross the blood-brain barrier, and it can cross the blood-brain barrier more efficiently as compared to atropine. That means more amount of drug can be cross the blood-brain barrier, and means when given at normal dose, only more of the drug of this hyoscine is available in the brain. Hyoscine. So hyoscine can be presented at higher amount in the brain as compared to atropine. Now what is the action of hyoscine in the central nervous system is it produces CNS depression. CNS depression means something like a sedation or sleepy kind of condition. Now this CNS depression kind of action can be used in the treatment of motion sickness. Motion sickness. Now what do you mean by motion sickness? Motion means you are moving, and because of moving you will become sick. Sick means there will be some vomiting. Like if you are traveling in a boat, the boat will be always shaking in the sea or in the lake or in the water wherever you are moving. So the boat will be always shaky, and because of that shakiness what happens, you will be a kind of imbalance. You won't be in a balance. I mean, you are not be able to stand normally in balanced condition. So you will become imbalanced, and when you are becoming imbalanced, there is a small substance which is present inside your inner ear, that is your vestibular apparatus. This vestibular apparatus is mainly concerned with the maintenance of your balance, and when you are getting imbalanced, so what will happen, the vestibular system will get activated. Okay, the vestibular system will get activated and it will give some signal to your chemoreceptor trigger zone, which is present in your medulla oblongata. When this chemoreceptor trigger zone will get activated, it will lead to vomiting. Okay, so basically how vomiting occurs means whenever the vestibular system, the vestibular apparatus will get activated. When they are getting activated means when you people are a kind of imbalance. Okay, imbalance means you are shaky, always you people are shaky. So at that time the vestibular system will get activated, and after activation it will cause activation of the chemoreceptor trigger zone, and chemoreceptor trigger zone when it gets activated, it leads to vomiting. Okay, it leads to activation of the vomiting center, and vomiting will happen. So this is the normal thing. Now how hyoscine can be used for inhibiting vomiting means this hyoscine molecule, it will mainly stop this thing, this communication. There won't be any vestibular activation that can cause activation of the chemoreceptor trigger zone. It depresses this thing. Since it is a kind of CNS depressant, it will depress this communication. When there is no activation of the chemoreceptor trigger zone, there won't be vomiting. So this is the mechanism of action of this hyoscine. So hyoscine, basically it is a kind of anticholinergic drugs which can move inside your central nervous system and can produce CNS depression, and this CNS depressant action can be used in the treatment of motion sickness. It is said that if you are this hyoscine to produce this treatment of motion sickness, then you should consume hyoscine before you are going for a traveling via boat or any shaky thing. Okay, so hyoscine is effective if it is taken prophylactically. Prophylactically means before you are about to go to any vehicle which is moving. Okay, so hyoscine can be it should be consumed nearly 4 to 5 hours before moving to a boat or aeroplane, any vehicle which is shaking, to avoid motion sickness. And even nowadays hyoscine transdermal patches are also been available. So this hyoscine transdermal patch, what you will do means you need to apply it behind your ear pinna, and you should apply it nearly 4 hours before traveling, and it will provide anti motion sickness activity for nearly 3 days. Okay, and hyoscine, since it is a kind of CNS depression, it is also able to produce sedation and amnesia. Okay, amnesia that too, anterograde amnesia. So hyoscine has been used to produce sedation and amnesia during labor. Okay, during labor. And previously this hyoscine was also been used for a lie detector in World War II. Lie detector means if you are telling lie, there will be anyone can catch you. So it can also be used as a lie detector. So these are the action of your atropine and hyoscine in your central nervous system. Now we have got one more class of drug, that is your anti-Parkinsonian drug. So this anti-Parkinsonian drug can also produce action on your central nervous system. See, basically what happens in your Parkinsonism means there will be an imbalance in the level of your dopamine and acetylcholine. Okay. So basically what happens in Parkinsonism, there will be degeneration of dopaminergic neuron. Means normally, in normal saying, there should be a normal balance between acetylcholine and dopamine. But what happens in Parkinsonism, there will be excessive damage of the dopaminergic neurons. And because of damage of the dopaminergic neurons, there will be a decrease in the level of dopamine. Okay, the level of dopamine will be reduced and there will be compensatory increase or unopposed increase in the level of your acetylcholine. And because of it, some symptoms of increased cholinergic action is been produced. So we can treat this Parkinsonism either by increasing the level of dopamine or by reducing the level of acetylcholine so that both should come in a normal level. So for reducing the level of acetylcholine, you can use certain anticholinergic drugs such as trihexyphenidine, procyclidine and bipyridine. Okay, so these agents can be used for the treatment of Parkinsonism. Not actually treatment of Parkinsonism, but few symptoms of the Parkinsonism can be inhibited by these anticholinergic drugs. And yes, very useful means we should use these drugs along with levodopa, because as such levodopa will increase the level of dopamine. So we can use anticholinergic drugs such as trihexyphenidine, procyclidine and bipyridine for reducing certain symptoms of your Parkinsonism. So these are the actions of anticholinergic drugs in your central nervous system. Okay, so these agents, since they can easily cross the blood-brain barrier, they can produce action in your central nervous system. Okay, so we saw the action of atropine, hyoscine and certain anti-Parkinsonism drugs. Next, we'll see the action of atropine in your eyes.